I often get asked, what's the fastest way to get a job as a software engineer without a computer science degree or without any work experience? Today, I want to share the path that I took and mistakes I made along the way so you can avoid them. The resources in this video helped me a lot, and I'm sure they will be helpful to you as well. By the end of the video, you will have a clear understanding and have action items ready to work on. Let's get into it. First is to pick a programming language. There are literally hundreds of programming languages out there, and each has its own benefits. After all, there's a lot of room for personal taste in choosing a language. As Beyonce Juice Drop states in his book, The C++ Programming Language, there are only two kinds of languages, the ones people complain about and the ones nobody uses. I started with Python because I was working a machine learning related project at school, and later switched to Java when I started looking for a job. Before I get into why I wouldn't recommend starting with Python, here are a few things I like about it. Python has simple syntax and is really easy to understand if people don't over-engineer their code. Also, it requires relatively fewer numbers of lines of code to perform the same operations than other languages. However, here are a few things that Python is not good for. Simplicity is not always good, especially when you're a beginner. Let's compare Python with Java. In Python, to declare a variable, you need to write x equals hello world. However, in Java, you need to tell the computer which type of information you want. In this case, string x equals hello world, because Java is a strongly typed language, a language where you are limited to the type system, which catches many newbie mistakes. Later, when you need to use x variable somewhere else in your code, you know it's a string type and it saves a lot of trouble. Another example is when working with more complex data structures like map or dictionaries, which stores a collection of key value pairs. In Python, you simply write something like this. As you can see, the keys can be either string or integer at the same time. In Java though, the keys and value types must be specified when map is declared. For example, if you want to create a map that has a string keys and integer values, you would declare like this. Using different types of keys can make the code less readable and harder to debug. When we don't define data types in Python, it's not because data types are not important in Python. The problem is they are not exposed in your code. Python is an advanced high-level language. In a way, it wraps a lot of things for you. In my opinion, this is not a good thing for a beginner. You need to know what's going on under the hood, so it's easier for you to write the code. For that reason, Java is a great starting programming language. You need to know things that happen under the hood, so you won't get into a mess when you write code. Another point I want to make is that Python gets a lot of attention for its so-called readability. But personally, I found reading and understanding Java code much easier due to its strong type and less advanced nature. So you know what's going on behind the scene. A lot of people might think, since I don't need to declare variables, it saves me a lot of time in an interview. But no, without defining types, it's easier to make mistakes and harder to debug. In an interview, it's the way that you approach the problem that matters, not fewer lines of code. But if you know you're only going to interview for machine learning positions or be a data scientist, then by all means, Python is the language to learn. After we pick the programming language we're going to learn, the next question is how to learn it effectively. I've followed many Udemy courses, tried different online tutorials, watched so many YouTube videos, but not all of them are worth the time. In this video, I picked the most useful ones so you don't have to waste the time and effort like I did. But there's one thing I want to point out. Learning a programming language, just like learning any other languages, the most important thing is to practice. You learn the language by practicing. Don't just play the video and watch it, hoping your brain will remember everything and process it, and you can start writing bug-free code. Take notes, revisit them, and practice. Practicing is very important because there is a gap between what you think you learned and what you actually learned. It's totally okay to run into bugs when you write your own code. In fact, it should be the norm. For me, this is the best way to learn. Get your hands dirty early on. Make mistakes. Learn from them. The first resource is Java Tutorial for Beginners by Mosh. The first part is free on YouTube. In this 2.3-hour long free course, you will learn enough Java to be called a Java beginner. It covers the most basic part of Java, including variable types, arrays, conditionals, loops, and more. you will build a mortgage calculator at the end. After this, I recommend another free website called Code Academy to practice Java. It is an interactive site, so you can code along while learning. This is what I mentioned previously, learn by practice. After we gain confidence in our programming language, next step is to get familiar with data structures and algorithms, since they are asked most often in our interview. But before you get into learning algorithms, please set a good mindset. If you start with a mindset that they are very difficult and complicated, you are discouraging yourself unconsciously and splitting your momentum in half. Know that algorithms are logical ways to solve problems. That's all. Nothing fancy about them. An algorithm is a collection of well-defined steps for a given input, some values, and returns a valid solution for a specific class of problems. There are two free resources I recommend in this phase. The first course is offered by Princeton University on Coursera. It is taught in Java. The course is completely free. It is one of the, if not the best, to learn algorithms and data structures. The lecture is concise. I normally watch it at 1.25x speed, so it makes it more concise. The lecturer, Robert Sedgwick, is an extremely famous computer scientist and an author of several books. It has two parts, but I only finished part one and I think it is sufficient for interviews. If you have extra time, take another class called CS61B. It is completely free as well. It is offered by Berkeley and it is in Java. The course is well structured and comprehensive. It teaches you how to be a software engineer by having you tackle complex projects with lesser starter code. You will not only learn data structures and algorithms, but also how to test and debug large programs. I really liked the instructor because he made everything fun to learn. It is an overwhelming class, but it's worth it. Now we are equipped with programming languages, data structures, and algorithms. We are ready to start LeetCode. LeetCode is a popular tool that developers use to prepare for technical interviews. The problems there are very similar to the questions that are asked in real coding interviews. There are over 2,500 problems on LeetCode as of today. And for sure, we need some strategy to tackle it. Don't get me wrong, I'm not asking you to finish all 2,500 problems. We should develop a systematic way so we can get the most of it with the least number of problems. For me, the systematic way is by categories or by patterns. There are topics like two-pointers, binary search, breadth-first search, depth-first search, try, sorting algorithms, and so on. A good website is LeetCode Patterns. In that, you can find different patterns. And of course, you can always develop your own pattern list later on. Pick a topic and solve problems with that. The recommended easy, medium, and hard problem ratio is 3:5:2. When you pick a topic, sort them by acceptance rate and frequency. Frequency is a premium feature. So if you didn't buy premium, you can just sort by acceptance rate. For beginners, if you tried 20 minutes and cannot even think of a draft solution, I would suggest looking at the solution right away. Understand the solution and code it up yourself. Don't feel bad because 95% of people start from there. The four big mistakes that I made, which you shouldn't, are: first, LeetCode can be done in a very short amount of time. This is not true. Like anything else, you need time to program your brain into that mode. Second, people don't explore the problem further. You should look at the discussion, even if you pass all the test cases, especially the top-rated one. Almost always, there are better approaches that people have solved. Sometimes, their time or space complexity is better. Other times, they might have better syntax that you can learn from. 3. Another mistake is thinking that solving the problem once is enough. Track your progress and revisit them multiple times. Start maintaining a record of questions you do on an Excel sheet. Record things like question link, difficulty level, finish date, things to be noted, whether it's algorithm or simply missing edge cases. Number 4 mistake is memorizing the answer to solutions. Try to understand the problem instead of hard coding it into your brain. This way, when a new problem comes, you know which approach to take. So how many problems is enough? I don't think there's an exact number. The focus has to be on quality instead of quantity. Don't compare yourself with others. There are people who have solved more than 600 problems and were not lucky to pass the interview. And there are some who solved 100 and got offers from multiple companies. Follow your own path. When you can solve a medium problem under 45 minutes, I think you are ready. Next is to apply. You can start applying for jobs at LinkedIn or other platforms. I use Easy Apply a lot, and that's how I got several of my past interviews. I don't want to talk about interview in this video because it's a broad topic and would need a video of its own. Just keep in mind, don't be scared of failure. Luck plays an important role here, and that's not something we can control. All we need to do is keep trying and don't blame yourself for the failure. Well, that's all for today's video. I hope it's helpful, and I'll see you next time.